The Tom Mix Straightshooters are on the air. And here comes Tom Mix, America's favorite cowboy.
Up, Tony, cowboy.
When it's roundup time in Texas and the bloom is on the sage, then along to be in Texas, back a riding on the range. How it beckons, and I reckon I would work for any wage. To be free again, just to be again, where the bloom is on the same.
The Tom Mix Straight Shooters bring you another episode in the mystery of the Flying City. Tom Mix is in a tough spot, and no one knows it better than he does. Waging a battle against the clever and crooked promoter, Morgan Garrity, Tom has bought up every one of the ranches Garrity wanted to get his hands on, promising to pay for them in 60 days. Anxious to help the hundreds of aircraft workers and their families, all of whom have come to Dobie County to work on the Twin Rivers Aircraft Corporation's Flying City, Tom has also guaranteed to find homes for them. Where in the world he'll find them is a seemingly unsolvable problem. But there's more trouble than this in store for Tom, as we're about to find out. We find ourselves once again in the Dobie hotel room that serves Morgan Garrity for an office. Garrity, in shirt sleeves, is pacing the floor. His henchman and right-hand man, the cadaverous man with a face like chalk who is known as Mr. Sims, sits at Garrity's desk. Sims is the first to speak.
If you ask me, you'll wear yourself out walking up and down like that.
I'm not asking you.
Okay. Not gonna get you anywhere. Getting mad, I mean. This calls for calm, cool thinking, if you ask me.
I may not be calm and I may not be cool, but I am thinking. Sims, this fight between Mix and me has come to the point where the winner will be the guy who can hold out the longest.
If you ask me, that'll be Mix.
You think so, huh?
Don't you?
No. Since when do I put my tail between my legs and start howling like a whipped dog when the going gets tough?
I know, but if you ask me...
Nobody asks you. Get smart, Sims. Use your head for something besides a hat rack. I said this fight had reached a point where whoever held out the longest would win. Well, I am the one who'll hold out the longest.
Yeah, but if Mix has the land and you can't build, and it's costing you a small fortune every day for these workmen...
It won't last long. In a spot like this, Sims, you gotta be sharp, act smart. Travis Penrose telephoned this morning and started to tell me what he thought of me. I let him finish. Then all I said was, Mr. Penrose, you need houses for these workers. No houses, no workers. No workers, no Flying City. I guarantee to build those houses, and now you want to fire me and let Tom Mix take over. All right, I said. Let Mix take over, see what happens. As for me, I'm quitting. That took the wind out of his sails. He began to backwater so fast it made me laugh. Let's not be hasty, Mr. Garrity, he says. Perhaps I was wrong. So I went around there. Instead of Penrose firing me, he's gone to Mix now to demand just where Mix is going to get the houses.
Yes, but what about...
Right, let me finish. Well, yeah. So Mix has bought up the ranches of his friends. He's got the land. But he got it without paying one red cent for it. Got it on a promise to pay in 60 days. Now, the way he angles it is this. Before the 60 days are up, I'll be forced out. The ranchers will change their minds about wanting to sell the old homestead. And Mix merely turns the land back to them. Well, that isn't the way it's going to work. It's not going to work that way for two reasons.
What are they?
First, I'm going to convince those ranchers that Mix or no Mix. They were fools to accept one man's word when another man is offering cold, hard cash.
If you ask me...
Nobody did. Leave it to me. I'll convince them, or I'm not the promoter I think I am.
What's the second reason?
Just to be sure of everything, we get rid of Mix.
We get rid of Mix?
Well, you do.
Now, wait a minute. Mokes is hot now. Mokes has got to keep undercover after that beating he gave Edwin Frisbee. And if that kid dies, Garrity...
Never mind about Edwin Frisbee and never mind about Mokes. You're going to handle this personally.
I don't go in for killing, Garrity.
It's the first time for everything.
Look, Garrity, I'm not kidding. If you want Mix killed, you'll have to get somebody else.
Will I, Sims? Will I really?
You got me just where you want me. And you know it, don't you?
If you ask me, Sims, I have.
Meanwhile, at the TM bar, Tom faces his own problems. Standing at the window of his office, gazing out at the rows of tents that have been set up to house the workers temporarily, he's going over the whole situation in his mind when the phone rings.
Tom Mick speaking. Oh, hello, Doc. No, you're not disturbing me. Young Frisbee. Bad as that, eh? Well, whom would you recommend, Doc? Harlan Radcliffe? Well, now, is this Dr. Radcliffe the best brain surgeon to be had, Doc? I see. Well, how much? What? Oh, no. No, of course, Charlie could never pay that. Oh, he might go a couple of hundred, but... Well, Doc, if you feel that Edwin may die without... Yes. Well, then... Yes, I see. Then get this Dr. Radcliffe. I don't care what it costs. We can't fool around with a boy's life. We'll tell Charlie it'll only cost him about 150. You needn't mention that I'm paying the rest. Then he won't feel that anybody's handing him any charity. Yes. All right, Doc.
Miss Tom, was that Doc Green?
Yes, boss.
How is young Mr. Edwin?
Very bad. X-rays show a fragment of bone pressing on the brain.
Oh.
Not the kind of operation that Doc Green could perform. He's getting in touch at once with a brain surgeon in Frisco. He figures the operation will cost about $5,000.
Oh, woe is me. That sure is a lot of money, Mr. Tom. A lot of money. Yes, and speaking of money, you know, we spend it fast on all these folks that's living with us.
Food bills high?
Well, so just look at them, Mr. Tom. You can see here for yourself. It's just like Mr. Mike say, they're eating us out of house and home.
Yeah. It is costing a lot, but...
Yes, sir.
Well, Wash, let's hope it won't be for long.
Well, Mr. Tom, I just been thinking, what happens if it comes to 60 days when you promise to pay the ranchers all that money and it don't turn out like you was hoping? I mean, suppose the rancher still wants to sell.
I'd have to buy it, Wash. I gave my word.
For twice what them ranches is worth?
Well, that's what I offered for him. I had to meet Garrity's offer.
Yeah, I said, but where are you going to get all that money? He runs into hundreds of thousands, don't
he? Well, I'll worry about that when the time comes, Wash. My plans go all right. Every rancher who was itching to sell his ranch will want to keep it. And I'll be able to hand it back to him.
Well, so it seems like to me that's counting an awful lot on folks' good sense.
Well, I'm counting on their hearts and not their heads, Wash.
Yes, sir.
I know how I'd feel if I had to leave the TM bar. I expect when it came right down to it, they'd all feel the same way. No, I'm not particularly worried about that at the moment, Wash. What does bother me is how and where I'm going to get living space for all these folks.
Oh, golly, too goodness, Miss Tom. I don't see why that should be your worry.
I'm taking it on myself, Wash. I had to if I'm to beat Garrett at his own game and drive him out of Dobie.
Well, land sakes to Bessie. Come to cold weather, these here folks are just can't go on living in tents like soldiers. It might be all right for the men's, but the women folks and the children's, I would... What is, Miss Tom?
By heaven, Wash, I think...
Huh?
Yes, you have. You've given me the idea I needed.
I has? Well, good for me. What's the idea I give you?
Wash, you said those people couldn't go on living in those tents like soldiers. Leastways, not in cold weather.
Yes.
Now, what did our soldier boys live in during the winter?
What do you call them?
Quonset huts.
Yeah.
Don't you see, Wash, if we could get enough Quonset huts from the Army...
Well, of course I see, Mr. Tom. Yes, sir. That's a wonderful idea. Yeah, but how did you go about getting these here sunset huts?
Well, Colonel Christie ought to be able to help me there. Wash, have Vinegar John saddle Tony. I'm heading for the Twin Rivers Air Base pronto.
Yeah, sir, and me, I'm heading for town in the limousine. Anything you want, I should get you while I'm there.
No thanks, Wash. Just get Tony saddled and hurry.
That rug will be the death of me yet.
And so as Tom hits the trail for Twin Rivers, Wash hits the trail for town in the W8 limousine.
If I don't get me some new shock absorbents in this here old limousine, there ain't gonna be no more Shamrock Home. And also, I just naturally gonna shake myself to death. That's silly for me to talk like that, though. Of course, I just funnin', but some folks will take it all mighty serious. Dickson. That's why I gotta take me some lessons. Blowout. Ain't that something? Shamrock Holmes after the quarry. Got to stop and fix a flat tire. Yeah, if it can be fixed. Got so many patches on it now, look like a bed cover. No sense just talking. Get out, boy. Get out and get to work. Door come off again. Well, I reckon I got to put it back on with something stronger than rubber band next time. Now, let me see here. Let's have a look at the tire. Just look at that thing there stuck in here. A round, heavy piece of iron. It's a kind of an iron bar with a sharp edge in one end or something. Could have been a chisel, maybe, once. A sharp, rusty part just stuck right into the tire there. A place to... Wait a minute. That ain't rust. Well, Lance, next to Betsy, there's blood. All dried and caked and covered with dust from the road. Sir, that's what it is, all right. Now, wait a minute. Hold on here, Shamrock. Hold on. This is a stroke of luck. A stroke of good luck. On account of this piece of iron, this here iron bar, I'll bet it's the weapon the quarry used when he beat up young Mr. Edwin. Yes, sir. This is the weapon. That means it is the clue that will lead me to my man.
Some hours later, as twilight falls over the range, another scene takes place at Wolf Creek. You know where Snake Bridge is, the narrow wooden bridge that crosses Wolf Creek just below the Circle S? Well, in the bushes that line the creek, a man is carefully concealed. A tall, thin, cadaverous man with a face as white as chalk. That's right, Mr. Sims, of course. Kneeling on one knee in the bushes, unseen but able to see, Mr. Sims keeps his eye on the wooden bridge, Snake Bridge, and the road that leads to it. Suddenly, out of the twilight, a rider bulges into that road, coming at a canter. Even at this distance, we recognize that rider for Tom, the horse for Tony. Of course, that's the road that leads to Twin Rivers. Tom is on his way back from sea. Wait a minute. There in the bushes, something gleamed. Sims is holding a rifle. But that gleam couldn't have been the blue steel of the rifle. So that's it. A high-powered rifle with a telescopic sight. A telescopic sight. He can't miss. Sims can't possibly miss at that distance. If only there were some way of warning Tom, of letting him know the danger that lies just ahead. But there isn't. All we can do is stand by and watch hopelessly. Sims murmurs.
Yes, when he hits the bridge, I'll get him then. When he crosses Snake Bridge, and I can't miss, I can't miss.
Straight shooters, there's mile-a-minute action and thrills galore in store for us tomorrow. So don't fail to be with your pal Tom Mix for the next thrill-packed episode of The Mystery of the Flying City. There goes Tom Mix, America's favorite cowboy. But he'll be back with another exciting adventure tomorrow evening, same time, same station, when the Tom Mix Straight Shooters are on the air. Tom Mix was played by Curly Bradley. Don Gordon speaking. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
This audiobook production was distributed by Brilliance Audio. For further information concerning this program or other Brilliance Audio titles, please call the following toll-free number, 1-800-222-3225, or visit our website at www.brillianceaudio.com. No part of this recording may be played for an audience or reproduced in any form. It may not be streamed, downloaded, broadcast, or copied without written permission. Address all inquiries to Brilliance Audio, P.O. Box 887, Grand Haven, Michigan 49417.